Hi guys, welcome to round two of Indie April. In the last video, I introduced you to the first novel that I ever wrote, how that came to be, where the inspiration came from, and you know, what happened to it. So today I'm going to move on to this book, Angorichina, which was actually the second novel I ever wrote and the first one that was ever published. Now, I better begin by explaining the pronunciation. So a lot of people struggle with saying this because it actually says Angorichina, but the way that we were taught to say it when we went there was Angorichina, as though you're reaching for something. So Angorichina. Now, it's usually a good idea to name your book with a title that is easy to type into Amazon and Google. But in this case, it's the name of an actual place. So I kind of thought I'd just stick with it and spend the rest of my life explaining how to say it. So it really all began in 2003. Now, I just graduated from my BA at Reading University and moved in with my friend Phil. We both decided that we kind of had enough of Reading. We love the place, but you know, we've been there for enough years, we needed to go and do something else. And so we decided we would go on a walkabout. And at that time, at the age that we were, which was in our early 20s, we decided to get working visas and go and spend a year travelling around Australia. And it was an incredible year. We started off in Sydney, where Phil had some family, and then we went down to Melbourne, and then up to a place called Swan Hill, which was in the middle of fruit picking country. And we stayed there for a couple of months picking fruit. Never ever pick peaches. They are the fruit of doom. They are literally little balls of itching powder. Anyway, so we saved up and we ended up buying a really clapped out car called Grace, and we drove her all the way from East Australia across to West Australia along the Nullarbor. It was literally two weeks of driving and there was sort of nothing but this great expanse, this plain. It was really quite a crazy landscape. But we made it to Fremantle and we lived in a tent with a swimming pool just outside for several months. And then we ended up going up to Alice Springs, down through the Red Centre, so Ayers Rock, Uluru, Catatuta, and where else do we go? Coober Pedy, which is this crazy town that's entirely built underground, an opal mining town entirely built underground. Go and look that up, Coober Pedy. It's a fascinating place. And then we ended up in the Flinders Ranges. So we were coming down towards Adelaide, we're in the Flinders Ranges, and we stopped off for a night at a backpacker's called Angorichina. Now, you know, I kind of guess it's strange that of all of the places that we went all over Australia, that I would choose a place that we only stayed for one night to write about. But it really kind of had a bit of an impression on me. I think it was the same with Lucid. Many of my books, they begin as a little kind of fascination, a little piece of grit in the back of my brain that just keeps twisting and turning until eventually it falls out in a book form. And Angorichina, it was, I think it was a sheep farming station. But it had had a history as a tuberculosis sanatorium. So back in the days before antibiotics, there were a lot of diseases that are very easily cured today that weren't curable back then. And tuberculosis, TB, was one of them. It's also called consumption. And when I was a kid, I thought that was like, I thought consumption was alcoholism because I thought you consumed so much that you anyway. Yeah, no, I wasn't a very bright kid. But anyway, so tuberculosis, if you got it, it infected your lungs and it slowly ate away at your lungs. And it could either kind of spontaneously cure itself and you could go home, or it would just keep going until your lungs became nothing. So it was a really horrific disease because it could take years and years, or it could recur, or it could just really hang around for a very, very long time. And there was nothing to do but go off to one of these sanatoriums and sit there and wait to find out how you were going to leave again, either through the door or, you know, in a coffin. So it was a strange kind of environment. I think that's what drew me to Angorichina, because we spent one night there and we sat outside with a fire and we're eating kind of bangers and beans and just sort of chatting away to other travellers. But there was always a sort of a silence behind it. You know, there was laughter, we were talking, but there was a silence behind it. And I kind of thought it was a very interesting place, but a very interesting idea that people from all over the country would end up there, you know, so as not to infect other people in their communities or their families. They would be shipped off to these sanatoriums. And so you didn't really get a choice in who you were there with, you know, whether you got on with the people there or you didn't get on with the people there, suck it up, you know. And I thought that was a really, really interesting one. The thought that you're sitting there contemplating your own mortality and contemplating everything that you've left behind and afraid of what might be coming. And at the same time, you've got to deal with all of these other characters around you. So that's what really caught my attention with this story, because I set it in, I'm going to go with 1932. Yes, 1932. And, you know, a few years later, around 1940, the first commercial antibiotics came on the scene. And so that kind of, it was kind of a stark contrast to me that, you know, how quickly history can switch, either in your favour or not in your favour if you didn't live to see antibiotics, you know, that you were there going through all of this and your life depended on this one little pill that would be available just a few years later down the line. I thought that was kind of an interesting a sad thing to sort of realise how close you were possibly to a cure, but you didn't get it. Anyway, I did get a bit emotional about this book, actually. It's quite an emotional book. It was also written a very long time ago, because again, I wrote this in, I guess, around 2000 and... probably started it 2008. 2009, just after I finished the very first draft of Lucid, because Lucid was, to me, it was the can I write that number of words book that every author goes through, every first time author goes through it. Can I just write enough words to make a novel? And when I realised that I could, and when it was shortlisted for the Luke Bitney bursary in 2009, I then turned my mind to thinking, can I write a good book? Not that Lucid wasn't good, but it was a first novel, and it was sort of a bit of a horror, sci-fi, adventure, thriller novel, you know. And I always loved reading literary fiction, and I wanted to know if I could write literary fiction and if it would be any good. I made several attempts to begin this book. Now, Lucid was written in third person, past tense, which is a very normal format for novels in the English language. We do tend to really favour past tense, third person novels, especially if it's genre. And I sat down to do the same with this. So my first few attempts at Angorichina was, the idea that I had in my head was of this guy lying in bed, you know, kind of watching, not to get too grim about it, but sort of watching the bodies being removed from the hospice and kind of contemplating his own mortality as to, is that going to be me? But I was going to have him as a bit of a sort of a suave, sophisticated, cocky kind of businessman who kind of found himself in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the Australian outback from the city, and having that kind of adjustment period. And I tried, and I maybe got to 6,000 words, 10 tops. And every time I walked away again, and I just thought, you know what, it just doesn't feel convincing. I don't feel invested. Like, I've got this really emotional subject that I want to talk about, and I'm not feeling it coming through in this first draft. And I think that a lot of authors have this, especially if you write several books, you know, more than one novel, that you tend to know that the novel has got legs once you pass a certain number of words. For me, it's usually around 20,000. If I can get beyond 20,000 and I'm still writing, I know that's probably going to be a good book. But I could never get anywhere near that. Tea break. And then I was sitting in my little round hut in Kissamente, which I've talked about before. And it was an evening, and I was just sitting there desperately trying to get some words to come out of me. And I don't know what it was, and it's going to sound really weird, but I felt like there was somebody there. I know it sounds silly, but I sometimes, and I'll go into this a bit more in other books, but every now and again, I feel like I can almost see the characters, like that I can sense them, like they're almost there. And so I was sitting there, and this gentleman sat at the table opposite me, and I could see him really clearly. He was a very gaunt looking man with a sort of a wide brimmed battered old hat. He was just an old bloke. And before long, there was a woman with him. And all of a sudden, it felt like the story literally just fell out of me. It just went woof. I switched from third person past tense to first person present tense, and it just boomf, it went. And I started writing, and it just kept coming. And I felt like the characters were there. So it's told from four people's point of view, multiple first person. Not everybody's a fan of that, but for this book, I think it worked. And it was the first time I think I'd ever written in first person. And it was a game changer, because I've always felt like I can really express a character in first person. And I think it's because I have a drama background. So I did 2 years at drama school. I did a 3-year theatre BA. And, you know, I spent most of my formative years pretending to be other people, and really trying to get inside the head of other characters, fictional characters and people. And so for me, that comes quite easily, is I can pretend to be another person quite quickly, quite well, and feel as though I know what the world looks like from another perspective. And alongside that, there was, when you're at drama school, you do a lot of very strange exercises. And one of them is called hot seating. So hot seating is where you get into character and you sit on a chair and other students fire questions at you, and you have to answer those questions as though you are the character. So not yourself, but as though you are the character. And I felt like I was hot seating imaginary characters through this all the way through. If I got stuck, I would have a conversation with this imaginary person in front of me and just say, you know, so what was it like? What, tell me something that made you happy. Tell me things you didn't like about living there. And it was like the answers would just come very, very quickly. And that just turned into Angorichina. And there are four characters in this book, and one of them to this day, I still think you shouldn't have favourites. You know, your books are your children, your characters are your children, you shouldn't pick favourites. But I think of all the characters I've ever written, I think Sean Buchanan might be the one that I have a particular soft spot for. I don't know. There's just something about him. There's something very human about him. He's a grouchy old bugger. He really is. He doesn't socialise well, but he cares very deeply, especially for one of the younger patients, Heath, who he kind of takes on board as a son, because this is what I'm saying, you know, you're thrown out into this sanatorium, you get no say over who else is there with you, and, you know, you're creating a family or you're creating relationships with people that you would never have met under any other circumstances. I guess that was a little bit like VSO looking back on it. You know, people that became your closest friends because of shared experience, intense shared experiences. Anyway, I'm rambling. I ramble a lot. You might have noticed this. But yeah, it was just a story that I felt had so much heart, you know, and I gravitate towards darker stories because I think those are the most intense and therefore interesting situations. The ones where you're really confronted with who am I? Why am I here? Is there any point to anything? You know, and it could be a depressing topic, but I feel like that really pushes you into very interesting territory as a writer. I saw a meme years ago, I don't know if I can find it again, but it basically said that the most popular topics for books by, you know, miles is sex and death. So yeah, I guess so, kind of intense experiences. I need to stop saying the word intense, but intense experiences that we all go through in life that bring out questions that need answers, damn it. So, four characters, and they've each got their own kind of emotional baggage. They're all older characters apart from one, and they've all got their history and their baggage and their secrets, and, you know, it all starts to come out. And to unravel. I did so much research for this, and it was the first historical fiction work that I ever wrote. Later, I guess, others in that category would be Rosie Hours. I know The Children of Lear. Oh my God, the research. In fact, this was the first time that I ever realised how much research goes into historical fiction. It is endless, but also enjoyable. So there's that. But I'm going to tell you about a little synchronicity. In fact, there are a lot of synchronicities with this book. So synchronicities are coincidences, and they are just coincidences, but they feel like they carry some kind of strange weight to them, like they're more than just coincidence, but they are just coincidence. Anyway, so during the research for this, I was on a lot of forums. I was sort of writing as well to Angorichina, asking for information. I went onto a lot of health websites to research tuberculosis, as well as South Australia at that time. And towards the end, I think I'd already pretty much wrapped up my manuscript. And somebody in a forum said, did you know that there is a short story by an author called Somerset Maugham, a British author called Somerset Maugham, about a sanatorium? And I went, no, I did not know that. And then I made it a bit of a mission to try to find that story. It's now available, if you do want to go and listen to it, it's now available on Audible. It's in a collection called Rain and Other Stories by Somerset Maugham, and it's a really nice collection. I'm a big Somerset Maugham fan now, thanks to this. But basically, I made it my mission to try and find this short story, and I couldn't back then. I was looking high and low, and I couldn't find a copy of it. And I think it was about a month or two after this had been accepted for publication, I was in Bath with my friend Graham, and we were just going through the charity shops, and there was a book. I'm always into the bookshelves at a charity shop. And all of a sudden, I found this doorstop of a book. It was about 5 inches wide. It was this big. It was a doorstop of a collection of about 60, 65 stories by Somerset Maugham. And the Sanatorium was in there. So went up to the till, bought the book, went back to his house, and he was cooking breakfast. And I was sitting on the couch in the front room. And whilst he was cooking breakfast, all he could hear was me in the other room going, "What? Fuck? Fuck?" I turned into Father Jack, basically. And he came through to see what had happened. And I was just in this stunned state, because the number of coincidences between his short story and my novel were off the scale. The premise of the story, or the main part of the story, is that there are two old blokes in there who do not get on and spend their entire time trying to make each other's lives miserable until one of them dies. Yeah, that kind of happens in mine as well. There's two old blokes in there, really don't like each other, Sean and Joe, and they spend most of it just trying to get under each other's skin until the end. Okay, fine. I mean, that's okay. In his short story, he has a female protagonist, and she is described as being very pale skin, red hair. I've got one of those as well. Laura Wheeler. I've got one of those. And she's also pale of skin and red hair, who becomes the love interest of one of my characters. And same thing happens in his story. Okay, so I'm getting a bit uncomfortable now. What else happens? There's an old military guy in his story, and there's one in mine. And then, the point at which I think I said the loudest expletive, we both have a character called Templeton. Templeton. I mean, that's not the most common name in the world. It certainly isn't. And we both had it. So in his book, Templeton, I think, is, if I remember correctly, one of the patients. And in my book, Templeton is the name of the guy. I think, does he appear on the first, second, third page? He's the guy who drives the patients out from the railway station to Angorichina. Templeton. Spelt the same. And I just sort of sat there and I was going, no, this is getting ridiculous. But it was too late, because it was already being published. And yeah, I did suffer a little bit of anxiety at that point, because I was thinking, you know, the likelihood that somebody knows this story, this short story by Somerset Maugham, from, I guess, the 1920s or 30s, and then also reads my book is very slim. But if they ever did, they'd think that I plagiarised it. And I was sitting there going, oh, but you know, these things happen and they're strange. And my friend Graham laughed about it and said, well, maybe you just channeled the spirit of Somerset Maugham. And I kind of looked at him and I said, yeah, well, I wish he had something fresh to say, you know. But anyway, if you ever do read both of those things, I didn't even know that story existed until this was almost finished, and I didn't read it until after this was published. And that is my case, Your Honour. So, you know, these sort of synchronicities tend to happen quite a bit. You know, you think you've written something entirely new, and it turns out you really haven't. So the other learning curve in this book is I was like in my late 20s when I wrote this book, and I didn't fully at that time understand all of the nuances of copyright. And I had actually done what a lot of new authors do, and I'd written song lyrics into the book. I thought that I had been clever about it. I thought that I had only chosen songs that would be well out of copyright by that point. But what I didn't realise is that the songs, the music, possibly the vocal recording, was out of copyright. But lyrics weren't. The written word has the same copyright protection as, say, a written novel, and lasts a hell of a lot longer. But because I'd chosen lyrics that had been written around the 1930s, and, you know, early 1930s, late 1920s, it was really difficult to find out who owned the copyright. Because a lot of the music companies that were around in the 20s and 30s had merged with larger conglomerates later on down the line. And it was really, really difficult. Eventually, I came across a group called the Harry Fox Agency, I think. And they were brilliant. They were able to direct me to the correct places. But my God, it got expensive fast. This is a labour of love. And so I did pay for all except for one of the lyrics. One of the lyrics I took out because it was just getting to be too much. But I kept, what did I keep in here? A Boy and a Girl Were Dancing, 1932. Honeysuckle Rose, 1929, Fats Waller. If I Had You, 1928. And Sing You Sinners, I think it's The Hi-Hatters, I think, 1938. And yeah, so that cost me a pretty penny. But what was most infuriating was trying to find how to give the money and how to get the rights, you know, paperwork through. Because I thought it would just be a case of, oh, I'll just email this company and they'll give me a payment code and I'll pay and, you know. Oh no. I actually drew up the entire chart of what happened and it was like pulling teeth. It went on for months and months. So I would never do it again. And yeah, I just couldn't help thinking that it seems really self-defeating that, you know, you have all of these lyrics and you have this music. And yes, copyright is there to make sure people don't steal it. But if you own it, you must want to sell it, you know, to make money off it. So why not have a sort of a unified database with all the big music companies where people can just go on there and say, oh, I want to use this and this, I'm going to use it for this. Approved, great. PayPal, great. Here's your piece of paper. You know, I mean, why would you not make it really easy to give you money? Yeah, because there are people out there who want to use stuff in legitimate ways and just wouldn't ever do it again because it's ridiculously complicated. And nowadays, if ever I see lyrics to songs, especially famous songs, used in people's books, I feel a little twinge of pain for the author because I know what they went through to get that. Yeah, and that would be my advice, is if you are, you know, if you are starting out writing, don't include lyrics. Just don't do it, especially if it's a well-known song, because that can run into hundreds just for a few words. And then the other problem that I have is, as with Lucid, this is a backlist book. And I told you about backlist books in the last video. So at some point, I would love to re-edit this. I would love to re-release it, maybe a different cover, you know, a different format. I would really love to turn this one into an audiobook because I think it would be a good one. But again, the problem is, because I've got the lyrics in there, if I was going to re-release this as another edition or as an audiobook in a different media format, I'd have to go back and pay again. Unless in the decade, in fact, more than a decade that this has been out, any of those songs and these lyrics have actually fallen into Creative Commons, not Creative Commons, but public domain. So it might be that they're all in public domain now, at which point I can just go and re-release till my heart's content. But if they're not, I really have to go and investigate that. So that was something I learned. So what did I learn from this book? Yeah, so I learned that, yes, I can write literary fiction. I can write historical fiction. Don't ever put lyrics in your book. And synchronicities, when you start writing, synchronicities start crawling out of the hole, left, right and centre. And it's happened to me so many times that I've been writing books and weird little things have cropped up. And with this book more than most, I owe a lot of the inspiration in this book to the Library of South Australia, because they have got a huge archive of photographs of Angorichina from that time. In fact, that is Angorichina at that time. And so many of the scenes in the book, like I think it's chapter four, I begin with two of the patients sitting on a hill, looking down at, somebody has built a little motif out of white rocks on the lawn, and it spells out "Our Home of Happiness." And I took that directly from the pictures because it existed. So there are details in the book that would never have existed if the photographic archive hadn't existed. And I took a lot of inspiration from looking at those pictures. A huge amount of inspiration from looking at the pictures in the archive and from listening to music of that day. And thank you, YouTube, because there's a lot of it online now. And that really gave me a sense of the place and the time. The other pictures that just really stood out. There was one picture towards the end that I came across, and it's just a group of patients standing outside Angorichina. But in it, I feel that I can see every one of my characters. I can see Sean, I can see Joe, Heath, Charlotte. They're all standing there, and I know it's not them. I know, you know, these are fictional characters, those are real people, but I feel like, you know, I don't know. Yeah, photographs are strange. What else? Oh yeah, there was another really weird synchronicity. So one of my characters is called Heath Dembo. And I was thinking around for characters. I still wasn't good at naming characters so much yet. I was a lot better in this book than I was in Lucid, but I still hadn't really got my method figured out yet. So Heath, I was going to call him Heath Bembo with a B, because there was somebody living in my village back home with that name. And I always kind of felt like Bembo was sort of it felt Australian. I know that sounds stupid. I know names don't feel like they're from somewhere, but it felt a bit Australian. It felt like it could have been an Australian character. And then I was flicking through the photographs and I came across this picture. And this picture is graffiti on the walls of one of the chalets at Angorichina. And it just stood out. Denbo, rather than Bembo, Denbo. And I just sort of sat there and I thought, of all the names that I could have picked, to have one that was so close to the name of an actual patient there, and that combined with the whole Templeton thing, I was just sitting there going, this is a weird, 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 weird story. So it was just full of creepy little instances. Which is fitting because, you know, it's sort of a ghost story. It's not a ghost story, but it's sort of the souls and the lives that went on within a place that no longer is used for that purpose anymore, you know, and how, what was this, 1930, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 92,000. So in the 2000s, about 70 years later, some, you know, British girl turns up with a backpack, sits there eating sausages and beans by the fire and going, I wonder who used to live here. You know, it's one of those Sinead O'Connor moments where she's walking out towards Wuthering Heights, you know, looking around going, oh, who could have lived here? I think I'm going to make it up. So, yeah, it's got a kind of a place in my heart, this one. I felt proud of the writing in this. I would still love to go back and re-edit it because there are some errant semicolons in there. In fact, there's one semicolon on the first page that I wish that I could just rip out of there. So even though I'm proud of it, I would still very, very much like the chance to re-edit it, just mostly for grammar and punctuation. I mean, this one was proofread. There's nothing that wrong with it, but I guess it's just my style is different now and I'd almost like it to reflect that. But anyway, yeah, it's not an uplifting book, but it's a historical book and I think it's a very, very deeply human book. And I think I captured what I wanted to capture. So when you set out to write a book, it doesn't always turn out the way that you hoped it had. But as far as this one's concerned, this was probably the easiest book I've ever written. And it's one that I felt really did capture what I wanted to put in there, what I wanted to put out. And also it's a book with Sean Buchanan in. And, you know, I have a bit of a soft spot for him as a character. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. It was the first book that I ever wrote thinking, can I get published? The first one was written to see if I could make the word count. The second one was written to see if I could write something that would get published. And I got 13 rejections, two with really, really nice comments. One saying that they really, really enjoyed it, but they couldn't take it on. And another one saying the same, that it was very well written, but telling me that that literary fiction was extremely hard to sell. And actually saying if it had been 10 years earlier, he probably would have taken it. But at the time, he didn't feel he could sell it. So fair enough, writing is a business. But I ended up landing with a small press called Green Sunset Books. And they were really lovely about it and worked really hard and really did put in the effort with the proofreading. And, you know, just they really, really went for it. And I loved working with Green Sunset. And it was my first experience with a small publisher. And it was a really, really positive experience. And yeah, so this is still on sale. It's probably, of all of my backlist, it's probably the not so awful one. So of the three backlist books, if you want to pick one up, maybe this one. Yeah, but I would like to re-release it at some point and I would like to have an audiobook, but I need to go and see if it's possible. So yeah, if you are a writer yourself or if you're a reader, have there ever been any weird synchronicities with books for you? Like, have you read something and then it happened? Or, you know, did you read about a character and then meet somebody who like really was like that real life character? Or, you know, have you ever had any weird spooky coincidences around books and reading that just seem a little bit too serendipitous to be true? Let me know in the comments below.